Okay, so welcome to my third lecture. And today I will start with some slides because, okay, I mean, higher order Venus is really getting very complicated. So I'm not, will not be able to draw all those things at the blackboard, but at the end I will switch to the blackboard. Okay, so I want to give you a survey or an idea of what we are doing in higher order Venus. So yesterday I essentially talked about first order Venus, ordinary Venus. Yeah, okay, maybe before I start, here just a few papers where this basic theory of Venus was developed. So there are these three series of papers together with Jamie Mingo and then Piotr Snyadi and also Benoit Collins. And part three is more or less the one which really develops the theory for the higher order ones. And there were a couple of more papers. But I mean, the basic theory has not really developed much since then. And I hope now that the connection with topological recursion gives a new impetus for doing this. So maybe the only really basic thing which happened in the last year is this paper of Octavio Arismendi and Jamie Mingo, and which did a couple of things for second order Venus, but we hope that we can also do it for higher order Venus. Good, okay, so let me recall the frame. So what we have, the whole structure we are looking at is motivated by the limit of random matrices. And so what we are looking at, if we have matrices, then we are looking on classical cumulants, or Cn, applied to traces of powers of the matrix. So if I have just one matrix model, then those are the guys I'm looking at, and I want to understand the leading order contribution. That's the genus zero case. Of course, you can try also to understand the subleading orders, but in free probability, we are dealing with the leading order. That's tough enough. And I also think there is a lot of structure there. And so what we get in the limit, that's what we call the correlation moments. So I mean, it's a limit of cumulants, but still it should be considered as moments. Okay, and so I mean, if I have a random matrix, yeah, random variable, random matrix, and I take the collection of all those numbers which I get, then that's what we call the distribution, the limiting distribution of this random matrix and of all orders. In first order, you would only look on C1 of one trace, which is just the expectation. But now, I mean, I'm going to understand all orders. Yeah, and now the crucial point in free probability is to understand what happens if I have not just one matrix, but if I have several one, and I want to understand the relation between them. And so let's just say I have two. And then, of course, I mean, I have the distribution of each of them. But more importantly, I also have the joint distribution, which means I can look on mixed moments between them. So I'm looking on the same quantities as before. I take the classical cumulants and I take traces, but now of arbitrary polynomials in the A's and the B's. And because these cumulants are multilinear, it's enough to have for the entries arbitrary products in A's and B's. Yeah, okay, and then, of course, if I, again, I mean, I give somehow a name to the limiting object, which I denote by phi n of the corresponding polynomials, and the collection of all those data is the joint distribution of my two matrices A and B. Yeah, okay, and then the idea is that there is somehow kind of universal rules to describe this mixed, this joint distribution in terms of the individual distributions. So there should be interesting or many situations where you really have this, and this is in a random matrix picture is given if your matrices are in a generic position, which means that the eigenspaces are rotated randomly against each other. There's no relation between the eigenspaces, and the way of saying this is that you have two matrix ensembles and they should be independent, but I mean the eigenspaces should also be in a generic position, which is for example, the case if at least one of the matrix is unitarily invariant, which means if you multiply this matrix or conjugate it by a unitary, then the joint distribution of the entries does not change, which means this ensemble has a uniform distribution on the eigenspaces. So the relation between An and Bn is in a sense generic. Okay, and then in such a situation, the mixed moments of A and B is uniquely determined by the individual distributions of the A's and the B's. And this is determined by a kind of universal rule. And this rule is given by Venus. And of course, the point is to understand this rule. I mean, here I'm just saying, okay, you calculate something in a limit and this gives you a rule. So, I mean, by general principles, you know, it only depends on the distribution of A and the distribution of B. But of course, we have to understand this rule because it's not given a priori and it's not so clear. And that's, but it defines freeness, at least for higher orders. And first order freeness was defined in a different way, but then of course it was seen that it rises here in a limit. Okay, but our definition of higher order freeness is essentially what we get here in the limit. And maybe here's again an example, maybe a bit more complicated example as yesterday. Using slides has the advantage that you can show a bit more complicated formulas for a second order limit distribution of mixed moments. So you take the covariance of two traces and each of them is a trace of A times B. And then in the limit, I mean, if A and B are as before, I mean, independent and one of them is unitarily invariant, then you can calculate this covariance of these mixed traces in terms of covariance and expectations of the individual A's and B's. And you see, you get a couple of terms. They involve the first order distribution of the A and the B, the expectation of a trace, and they also involve the second order distribution of the A's and the B covariances. But in this covariance, you only have A's or you only have B's, but not mixed things. Good, okay, yeah, so that's the kind of formulas which we want to understand on a general level. And you see, I mean, it's even here for these simple examples, it's getting quite complicated. And may a priori, without doing really the calculation, it would probably not be clear how this formula looks like. Good, and so the idea is, in order to understand this formula, it's better to go over to other quantities, which we call cumulants. I mean, our moments, which we have, are actually limits of classical cumulants, but okay, forget about this. They are more like moments, and we introduce now some new kind of cumulants. And yeah, I mean, so we looked on some other canonical information about our random matrices, and essentially our moments are the Cn's of the traces of powers. But if you calculate this, of course, you calculate this in terms of the entries of your matrices. So this means maybe the more basic quantity, which you should understand, is the correlation functions for all the entries of your matrices. And actually, if I have a unitarily invariant matrix, then there is a lot of structure in these entries, and the cumulants of them, the only relevant ones, contain the fundamental information about how to calculate the traces. And so the Cn's of the entries of the matrix, their leading order, that will be actually our cumulants, which we consider. And maybe in order to calculate this, I mean, in the entries, I should only have somehow the information about traces of powers. For traces of powers, I only use a cyclic multiplication of all the matrices, and that should be the basic information which I'm using from the entries, and all the other entries should not really give a contribution. And I can achieve this if I really have a unitary invariant matrix, because then, I mean, all the other information which might be there, which corresponds to having specific eigenspaces is destroyed. So the only information which I see in the entries is then the information which is needed for calculating traces of powers. Okay, and the point is that if I have such a unitarily invariant matrix, then actually one has a kind of analog of a Wick formula for calculating those cumulants. A Wick formula usually tells you that if you, for Gaussian variables, if you calculate higher moments, you can determine then in terms of more basic information. In this case, just of second moments. And here, essentially, you have a formula which tells you if you calculate cumulants of the entries of your matrix, then actually you can look for more basic blocks. They depend on more basic things. And actually, so we have this Wick type of formula, which tells us that if I want to look on a cumulant of arbitrary collection of entries in my matrix, so I have I1, J1 for the first entry up to in, jn for the last one, then actually, because I have a unitarily invariant matrix, the I and the j indices must actually fit somehow. They must appear in a cyclic order. So this means each j index must also appear as an I index. So this means I have to find cycles somehow among those. And all those cycles which appear will make a contribution. That's why this unitarily invariance, this tells me exactly this. Okay, so maybe here's an example. Huh? So let's say I have such a unitarily invariant matrix. Let's say I'm looking on the entry 7, 9 of my matrix. Huh? Okay, and 7, 9, this is not a cycle. I mean, 7 is different from 9. And because of the unitarily invariance, I mean, it's clear that this guy must be 0. Huh? Okay, but then if I have for example, the entry 7, 7, this is a cycle. I mean, the first 7, yeah, the 7 at the first position matches the 7 at the second position. Of course, it is a one cycle. And so I get, of course, here something, and there's somehow basic information about what I really want. Huh? So I call this kappa of 1, corresponding to this one cycle. Then maybe if I have a cumulant of 3 entries, 7, 9, 9, 5, 5, 7, you see I have. Now I'm just looking on the ones where I can find cycle, because otherwise it is 0. And so here I have a basic cycle. So I have a 3 cycle here. So again, this is a basic information, which I call kappa of 1, 2, 3. Because the second index of the first one is the first of the second one. The second index of the second one is the first of the third one. So this really gives me this cycle. Yeah, but then of course I have also contributions where I can find more cycles in the index structures, because some of the indices are the same. So if I now look on 7, 9, 9, 7, 7, 7, of course I can say I have the 3 cycle which I had before. So this should make a contribution to this quantity, but there will be more, because I can also find 2 distinct cycles. Huh? So namely, I can go 7, 9, 9, 7. This is a 2 cycle, and then the 7, 7 is just the 1 cycle. So there will be another contribution which corresponds to this one. Okay, and so going on, you see that essentially I can break down the information about all those cyclic entries to more basic things, where I just consider cycles where all the corresponding indices are different. Okay, and then if some of the indices are the same, they will be a combination of those basic ones. Good, okay, so this is here, for example, for these examples, what I get. And of course, now I have my n by n matrices. Of course, all those things will actually depend on n. They have an n dependence. And what I want to understand, or what I keep in a limit, is of course just the leading order. And because I have made my assumption about what are the leading orders, or what is the order of the leading orders for the moments, so for those guys, I can also see that they behave in a specific way in N. Okay, and it's only the leading order which I keep. Of course, I mean, I have here formulas where I also have the subleading orders. So this is a kind of genus expansion. So in principle, there are formulas which go for subleading terms, but I will ignore them, because they are getting too complicated. Maybe they correspond to topological recursion in the end, but so I'm ignoring them for now. But okay, yeah, and so this means I just take the leading order of all those contributions, and so I will get kappas, or those are the cumulants, which are indexed by permutations, corresponding to the cycle structure. Good, and now, of course, the task is to see how are my what I call moments, so namely the cumulants of traces of powers, how are they related to these other quantities? And of course, in principle, if you want to calculate traces of powers, you write it in terms of the entries, and then you get many contributions, and you have to see, which survives in the limit and what is their contribution. And maybe here, let us look on this example. So this alpha 2, 1, this would be a second order moment where I take the covariance of the trace of A squared and the trace of A. And of course, I can write this, and the trace of A squared, I write this in terms of the entries as matrix multiplication and taking the trace. So I'm summing over all those indices. And you see, I only have the cyclic indices which show up there. And so I get something like this. But now I want to write this in the basic quantities and the base cumulant quantities. And for those, I should have the C's, where each entry is just one of the entries. Here you see I have here C2, but the first argument is a product of 2 entries, because I had the trace of A squared there. Okay, but for the cumulants of the entries, I really want to have the cumulants where each argument is only one entry. And this means I have here to use formulas how I can express cumulants where the entries are products in terms of cumulants where I just have the individual variables. And I mean, there are formulas for classical, I mean, for all the kind of cumulants we have, there are formulas like this. But in particular, there are such formulas for the classical ones. And so I can write this C2, where the first guy is a product of two things, and the second argument is alone. I can actually write this as such a sum of cumulants, where each of them only involves one of the entries. No products anymore. But of course, I have more complicated structure. In particular, I'm getting terms where I have products of cumulants. I get the highest order term, C3, where I just distribute the three entries. But then I also have lower order terms, which are products of second order, first order cumulants, and so on. Okay, and now I'm back to the guys where I really saw, if I have my unitary invariant ensemble, how to express them in terms of the kappas. And so I have to look for the cycle structures appearing in those guys. And of course, this depends whether the ij and k will be the same or different, how many contributions I get. Okay, and now I mean, it's getting, you have to see what possibilities you have. So in the first term, you get contributions corresponding to different cycle structures. I mean, some of them you only see if some of the ij and k are the same, but there will be terms showing up like this. And so you get a couple of terms which contribute to this. Okay, and so, I mean, this is really the structure of formulas, which we should, which we hope to understand. And so maybe here again, I have written it down for this example. So later on when I switch to the blackboard, maybe I'll give you also some pictorial interpretation of those formulas. But so I get the kappas of cycles. I mean, those are the things which I explained at the beginning, but you also get products of them. And this means what I need in my formulas are not just, I don't only need information about kappa where I have a permutation as an entry, that is essentially the cycle structure which counts, but I also have to take products of those guys. And this, I mean, we encode in object which we call partition permutation. So maybe here I just writing down, okay, how I would denote this. So I mean the first kappa, so this is a kappa where I have two cycles as an entry. So this is a kappa 2-1. So this is a second order guy. So the 2-1 tells me it has one cycle of length 2 and one cycle of length 1. The second guy, this is just one cycle, 1, 2, 3. And this is a first order contribution because there's only one cycle. So you see, we get here a mixture. We get here a mixture of first order and second order cumulants, but we also get products of them. And in order to also encode these products, we use this partition permutation. So for the first three terms, there are no products. So essentially, it would be enough to say what is the partition, what was the permutation. So I mean, the permutation for the first is a cycle 1, 2 and a cycle 3. For the second and the third, it's cycles of length 3. But for the other ones, it's a product of guys. And this means I put additional information there. Namely, I say I still have here cycles, but I mean, some of them go into the same kappa. And which go into the same kappa, for this I use that I take a partition of the cycles of my permutation. So I say which cycles belong together. Okay, so the second component here is a partition, a permutation. For example, here this kappa 1, 1, kappa 1, so the first of the fourth term. So there I have three cycles, the cycle 1, the cycle 3, and the cycle 2, but the cycle 1 and the cycle 3 are going into the same kappa. So the partition tells me that I should take those two cycles together. So I mean, the red part here is a partition, but this is a partition of the cycles of my permutation. And that's the reason why we introduce what we call partition permutations, which seems to be quite useful. And okay, I think the right object to describe the whole structure of these formulas. So what we have as our general combinatorial object is what we call a partition permutation. So which consists of a pi of a permutation, but then I also have to take a partition of the cycles. So I take some of the cycles together, because I mean, essentially what I have is a product according to the partition. And then each term in the product has the corresponding cycles there. So this is a pair of a permutation and a partition, but it's actually a partition only of the cycles. also which can denote by that the partition is bigger than pi. And pi I can also identify with a partition. Whenever I have a permutation, if I forget the structure of the order in the cycle, I can just say the cycle is a block, and then I can also consider it as a partition. Yeah. Good, okay, and so those are the guys which I'm using for indexing both my moments and my cumulants, and then I'm trying to get formulas between them. Huh? So the specific formulas which I saw before, I should be able to write them in a general way. Okay, and maybe just to make again clear what, if I index my moments or my cumulants with those guys, what they really mean. Huh? So maybe here, for example, let me consider these partition permutations where I have a permutation of 9 elements. So the second part with the round brackets that are the cycles of my permutation. And then I also have a partition which takes some of them together. And if I put this for my correlation functions for the phi, and I apply this to my matrices, then I'm really looking on cumulants of traces of powers, but I will get products of them. So this means here, And for the cumulants, I'm taking the entries of my matrices. So for example, here I have, so this partition has 3 blocks. And the first block is 1, 3, 4, 6, 7. And this tells me that I'm combining 3 blocks of my permutation. So the permutation, there's a cycle 1, 3, 4. There's a cycle 6 and a cycle 7, and they are combined. And so this part here tells me that I should look, if I'm looking on the moments, then I should take the trace of the cycle 1, 3, 4, then the trace of the cycle 6 and the trace of the cycle 7. And those are the entries of my C3. On the level of the entries of the matrix, I should take a cumulant where I'm putting in 3 different cycles as arguments, different cycles. So I have here 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1 as arguments. And then I have a 4, 4 as another cycle and 5, 5. So that's the first block of my partition, which tells me that I should take this. But then the second block of my partition, so 2, 5, 8. So this tells me that I'm combining the cycle 2, 8 and this the cycle 5 of my permutation. And so this will give me an additional C2 of the corresponding traces. Okay, and then there is the last part in my, the block in my partition, just 9, where I'm just taking the cycle 9 in my permutation. And so I just get on the level of the traces, I get just the C1 of the trace of C9. And for the entry, I just take C1 of some, I mean, C3 could also be C7 7, right? It doesn't matter because they are all the same because of the unitary invariance. So it's just that I take this cycle structure in the entries. Okay, so that's what I'm really doing. I mean, I'm indexing my moments and my cumulants with quite complicated objects. I mean, it's a partition of permutations, but the partition structure tells me essentially it's just a multiplicative decomposition. So essentially I look on functions which are multiplicative functions with respect to the partition structure. Okay, and then the factors which I get in this product, they are go with the basic element cycles in the permutation. Yeah, okay, and then, yeah, and now, of course, I have those objects, and I have many of them, and of course, in my formulas, if I'm connecting moments and cumulants, not all of them will make a contribution, and of course, the leading order should be somehow like a geodesic object. I should have a description to say what is really planar in this picture, and for this, it's good really to define things in terms of maybe a product of our objects and to really have a geodesic description. So what we can do is we define a length function on such pairs. I mean, it's very simple. I mean, it's just n minus, and this is just the number of blocks and the numbers of cycles. And then, I mean, one can check that this satisfies the triangle inequality. And this allows me to define a product of two such things, which essentially keeps track of the leading order. So I define now a product of two such partition permutations. And I just do, I mean, the only thing which I can do essentially on the level of partitions and on the level of permutations, of course, the product of permutations is somehow clear. So I mean, I'm multiplying the pi and the sigma. And for the partition, I take the sup. So I mean the partitions. So those are really partitions of all partitions. It's not the non-crossing ones. A priori, I have all of them. Of course, at some point, I will somehow get the non-crossing structure. But I mean, those are just all partitions, and I just can take the sup, so the maximal. So if I have two partitions, I can take the smallest one, which is bigger as both of them. So that's the sup. Okay, but in this product, I only want to consider the situation where the triangle inequality is actually an equality. If it is not, then I say this is zero, because it's really, essentially, I'm looking for decompositions which are lying in some sense on the geodesic, which means I only want to have that, I have this equality in the triangle inequality. Okay, so I define this, and then it turns out that all these relations which I have seen before, I can be formulated in terms of this language, I think quite nice way. So namely in particular, I mean, the main formula which we want is what is the relation between moments and cumulants. And so this should be the leading order in my formulas, as I showed you before examples. So this means I should be able to express moments in terms of cumulants, but I have to say which terms should I take. And actually, so I have here this sum, this moment cumulant formula. So on the left-hand side, I have this phi of this partition permutation u gamma. It's enough essentially to restrict this to the case where the u is just a partition 1n, which combines everything, because otherwise it's just a multiplicative factorization into the blocks. And of course, you have to check that this formula respects this multiplicative structure. But in principle, to define the cumulants, it would be enough to have for this U the partition which connects all cycles together. Okay, but you can extend it multiplicatively directly in this way. And then you are summing actually on the right hand side over partition permutations V, pi such that you find this kind of decomposition. I mean, in the first order case, you would say you sum over all partitions which are smaller than a given one. I mean, in this, you have a poset structure. The problem is we are not really able to formulate, to put a poset structure, a partial order on all those partition permutations. So our formulation, but we can formulate it in terms of factorizations into products, which you can also do in the first order case. And so in principle, this corresponds to the fact that you should sum over all partition permutations, which are in some sense smaller than the ones on the other side. But it's not really we are not able to find really a partial order on this set. But you can formulate it in this language. Okay, so there's a very precise formula for this. And then, of course, the main point is that, this you get from calculation. The question is the kappas which you get from this formula. And I mean, you can use this formula for defining them. Does it really have all the properties which you would expect? And of course, the basic main property of cumulants is that if your guys are free, then mixed cumulants should vanish. Right? And that's actually the case. So this means whenever I have here cumulants, where now I just take one term in my product. So the first, the partition is just this 1n. The partition which connects everything. So this kappa of 1 comma n is just one factor. Right? It's not a product of guys. It's just one factor. And in this factor, the matrices or the elements which you consider, if you have mixed guys, then this is zero. So you really have this property that mixed cumulants vanish. And in particular, I mean, this is always what you always have if mixed cumulants vanish. And then if you are looking on the sum of two guys, then the cumulants linearize your operation. So I mean, maybe this is even if you are not so much interested in understanding the joint distribution, but you just say, I have a random variable A, I have a random variable B, and they are free. How can I describe A plus B? Then this vanishing of mixed cumulants tells us that the cumulants of A plus B are just the cumulants of A plus the cumulants of B. But I mean, this is somehow, this is a consequence of the vanishing of mixed cumulants. This is also why cumulants are so powerful or valuable for calculating classical convolution or free convolution. Because moments of free or independent variables, they don't sum up, but cumulants, they sum. Good, and so everything you have to understand is somehow shifted to understanding the relation between moments and cumulants. Good, okay, so we have this here, but then even more, we also have a formula which somehow allows us to understand the product of two free variables. We want to understand, if I have three variables, the basic question is, of course, the sum, but actually we want to understand more. In the end, maybe we want to understand polynomials in our free variables, but maybe the next thing which you should also understand is the product. Those cumulants are also very useful for understanding the product, because we have a convolution type of formula, which even shows more the power of this factorization description. Because we have this formula that if you want the cumulants of a product of two free variables, so I have here a cumulant where all arguments are now AB. And I want to express this somehow in a cumulants where all arguments are either B or either A. And you can express this in this formula. So namely, you're now doing a decomposition. So you have a cumulant of the partition permutation u comma gamma of your product, and you say you can write this as a sum over all factorizations in this way, as I define the product of your u comma gamma in two factors, and then you get a cumulant of the a's going with the first factor and a cumulant of the b's going with the second factor. In first order, this comes down that essentially, you make a decomposition into a partition and its Guevara's complement. In the first order case, the second component is usually determined if you know the first component. On the higher orders, this is not true anymore. So for a fixed u gamma, you in general have several possibilities of writing it as a product, and all those contribute in this formula. Yeah. Good. Okay, so I think that was what I wanted to show you on the slides, and maybe now I'm going back to the blackboard and tell you a little bit more. I don't expect that you have understood all the details of what I'm telling here, but I hope it gave you at least some idea of the structure which we have, and that I think we have a quite precise and nice description. Of course, to understand what those formulas mean in detail, this is of course maybe a different question, and which we still have to understand maybe more. Good, okay, so now I stop the sharing, I hope. And let's see, so I'm back to the blackboard, and maybe first, I want to draw some pictures. I gave you this relation between the moment 2,1, how it is expressed in cumulants. And of course, this has a kind of pictorial description. And of course, it really corresponds somehow to having non-crossing pictures, because it's a leading order. So let me maybe talk first a little bit about this. So I had this α1,2. Which was the limit of the covariance, so the C2 of, let's say, the trace of A and the trace of A squared. Or maybe I had it the other way around, but anyhow. So, and there we saw that if you express this in terms of the kappas, you have a couple of terms, and those terms you can draw in a pictorial way. So namely, what you have here, of course, if you have a trace, you draw a circle, and the arguments which you have there are points on the circle. I could also put different A's here, but so I have a circle where I have one matrix, and I have a circle where I have two matrices, and now I have to look on making connections between all those guys in all possible ways, which should also be non-crossing. In this small example, everything is non-crossing, so the subleading order terms are not really here, but nevertheless. And so what you can do is essentially, you can connect this here by a permutation. I mean, this is the permutation, and this is just the permutation where I'm running around. I have a cycle of length 3, and this gives me a contribution kappa 2. But actually, I mean, I can also run in the other way. So I had two contributions coming from a cycle of length 3. Also, I also have a picture where I go from here to here in this direction. And this again gives me a kappa 3. And this kappa 3 are the first order contributions. So this means calculating the second order moment, I have some contributions which go with the first order, something like this. And then I have also possibilities where I'm maybe just connect two of them, and one is for itself. So I have here a two cycle and here one cycle, but those are just separated by the partition. So this would be a kappa 2, comma kappa 1. And there are more terms like this. I mean, there's also the other one. I connect it like this. This is also kappa 2 times kappa 1. But then there are also second order contributions. This is just first order, but then there are second order contributions. And this corresponds to the fact that actually I have a cycle, which I have cycles living on one circle and other cycles living on the other circle, and the cycles don't connect two circles. And then this partition is connecting those two guys. So I have the situation where I have those cycles, but then I connect this somehow in second order, and this would give me a contribution kappa 2 comma 1. So this is the second order contribution in this case. So this would be the situation where I have here one cycle, here I have a two cycle, but they are not taken together by the partition. They are connected by the partition. So the partition connects those two cycles, and this is a second order contribution. So this would be a kappa. Maybe I should write it in this partition permutation way. So I mean, I have here a cycle 1 and a cycle 2, 3 for my permutation, but the partition so connects those two guys. Whereas here, let me see. So maybe I can also have this if I have the kappa where I don't connect them. So I can have 1 and 2, 3, but I can say the 1 stays alone and 2, 3 stays alone as a partition. Then this would be a product of a kappa 1 and a kappa 2. So these are those terms. They go with this where the cycles here are not connected by the partition. Then this is just the product of first order terms, but here the cycles are connected by the partition, and then this will be a second order contribution. Good. Okay, but so maybe that's just, we have pictures like this. You can think of those in pictures like this, but maybe now let me come back again to descriptions in terms of generating power series, because I showed you yesterday on the first order level that this combinatorial relation between those quantities can be rewritten in terms of the Cauchy transform and the R transform. And at least for second order, we also have a description like this. So I mean, this combinatorial description we have for all orders. Okay, but if you really want to put it into more analytic terms, then going higher in the order is getting more and more complicated. So first order was not really so complicated. Second order was, I found it quite tough. And this was one of the results which we had in this part 3 paper on this. And so maybe, so let me formulate it here. So now let me just look on second order. And if I'm looking on second order, of course, I should take first and second order, because second order, the formulas also involve the first order. So this means I should have the moments, let's say of first order, call them alpha n, and the moments of second order, alpha m comma n. And corresponding to them, I should have cumulants of first order, the kappa n's, and of second order, the kappa n m comma n's. Huh? Okay, and then of course, and this is only if I have one random variable. Huh? So I mean, those are the moments of one random variable. Those are the corresponding free cumulants. And here are the second order moments of this. And now I can put, again, those guys into formal power series. And I can ask whether I can rewrite this combinatorial formula, which I had as functional relation for the power series. Okay, so I put the alphas in things which I call G. So of course, on first order, it's the same what we had yesterday. Huh? So I take G of X, so this is alpha L divided by X to the L plus one. And for the cumulants, we call it the R transform, R of X. This is the sum of L greater or equal one kappa L X L minus one. So here's this shift in L minus one. And here I'm looking on the quantities in essentially one over L. But now I also put the second order guys into power series. Of course, they have two indices. So this is something which depends on two variables. So I have the G of X1, X2. And I mean, it's this resolvent form. Of course, it's the phi two of the trace of the resolvent in X1 and the trace in the resolvent of X2. But it has this power series expansion alpha L1 comma L2 divided by X1 L1 plus 1 X2 L2 plus 1. And then I define correspondingly a second order R transform, which looks more or less in the same way, but in two variables. So it's R of X1, X2. So this is the sum over L1 and L2, starting from one, and then I have the kappa L1 comma L2, and I have X1 to the L1 minus one, and the X2 to the L2 minus one. Well, then the question is, so what, how can I relate those? Of course, I have the kappas are uniquely determined in terms of the alphas by this combinatorial description, but how can I write this down? And of course, on the first order level, that's just what we have yesterday, because I mean, for the first order, the second order doesn't play a role. So then we have, so it was this relation that the R transform and the quotient, maybe the other way around, the Cauchy transform and the R transform plus one over X is equal to X. So essentially R transform plus this pole here, this is the functional inverse of G. Okay, so that's formula due to Voiculescu. And now the question is, do we also have a formula on the second order level? And indeed we have. And so maybe the formula as we have it in our paper, let me write it the following way, X1, X2. So I can express this in terms of, other quant of actually of R2, but also involving, maybe I should write it in terms of R2 and R1, but actually it's simpler instead of R1 using G1 because they are related. So what I have is here G prime of X1, okay, G prime of X2. Then I have here the R transform, but the argument is G of X1, G of X2 plus one over G of X1 minus G of X2 squared minus one over X1 minus X2 squared. Good, okay, so that's what we derived. And now, I didn't know about topological recursion. I didn't know that maybe it's better to write things in terms of differential forms. And this was essentially, was in the paper of Guitton and Elba, that actually they noticed that this, of course, this fits totally into the context of topological recursions. In particular, if you write this here as differential forms, then it really shows that you have a symmetry between moments and cumulants. I mean, actually the quantity which you consider on second order in topological recursion, that, I mean, it's the same whether you look on it in terms of cumulants or in terms of moments. Huh? So I mean, I can, maybe it's better to write this in a differential form and bring in yeah, maybe also this on the other side. So maybe, so this is the same as saying gx1, gx2. Let me bring this here, 1 divided by x1 minus x2 squared. And then maybe let me write it as a differential form. And then what do I have on the other side? I have this guy here, r of g of x1, comma g of x2 plus 1 divided by g of x1 minus g of x2 squared. Okay. And then, of course, I dx1, dx2, but of course, together with this, maybe here I'm using as a variable g of x1. So, I mean, it's of course makes sense to write this as d of gx1 g of x2. Huh? Okay. And I mean, in this form, I mean, this is this omega 02, which you have in topological recursion. But here, this is somehow the omega 02, which corresponds to the moments. And here, it's somehow the omega 02, which corresponds to the cumulants. Okay, and so this, I mean, this was, I'm not sure whether this was the starting observation in the paper of, or by Guitton and Elba, but at least, I mean, they really, yeah, wrote it in this form. And then they also reproved those formulas in the language of ordinary maps and fully simple maps. They showed that you have this same relation on this level. And so this really shows that I think there is a quite substantial relation between topological recursion and let's say this, at least this transition between moments and cumulants. And as I told you yesterday, I mean, on the first order level, I mean, this relation tells me that the moments and the cumulants are somehow inverses of each other, which corresponds to the fact that you get them from each other by exchanging a topological recursion, the x and the y variable. And this tells you on the second order level, you preserve the universal kernel, which you have there. And then of course the question is, yeah, but then do you have also topological recursion? Or maybe if you have topological recursion for one of them, let's say for the moments, do you also have topological recursion for the cumulants? So, I mean, this is a question posed in their paper, and there are some kind of solutions. I'm not really sure what is the final status of this, but at least this is, I think, something where maybe we hear more in the talk on Friday, I think. I think this really raises the question. I mean, symplectic invariance for topological recursion somehow means that you should replace moments by cumulants, I think. Okay, and then the question is, if one of them satisfies topological recursion, is this also satisfied by the other one? And maybe in the last 10 minutes, I hope, I want to give you actually maybe a concrete represent. Yeah?
What question? This R function there, this is different from the ordinary function.
On the right-hand side of your equation, there's this R2. This is different from the ordinary Bergmann kernel. What does it mean then? Yeah. Is it some higher genus spectral curve?
No. I think in our theory, I mean, the moments you can prescribe in an arbitrary way. So this means I could prescribe for the second order guys anything I want, which has nothing to do with the Bergmann kernel. Okay, but if I have topological recursion, let's say for the moments, then this guy should be the Bergmann kernel. No? And then this tells me that this guy should also be the Bergmann kernel. I think that's the point. I mean, in our theory, we have freedom. I mean, there's no topological recursion a priori there for the moments or for the cumulants. But of course, we can ask the question, if I have topological recursion for, let's say, the moments, can I then construct other quantities which also have topological recursion, in particular the cumulants? And I mean, this here really shows that at least there is good hope for this, because I mean, at least on the second order level, you should have this universal object. And this tells you if you have it here, then you also have it here. But so maybe I want to give you one this transition between moments and cumulants actually can be given in quite precise terms in our language. So namely, we can realize it by conjugating things with a circular element. Yeah? And circular elements are very important objects. They are the limits of Ginepro ensembles. Huh? Okay, so let me say in our setting, I have a specific element C, but this is non-self adjoint, so I should always consider it together with its adjoint C and C star. So this, let me write it in a very imprecise way, is the limit of Ginepro ensembles, of Ginepro. The usual matrix is usually, up to now, maybe I talked about self-adjoint matrices, and the Gaussian matrices are the ones where the entries up to symmetry are all independent and have a Gaussian distribution. The Ginepro ensemble is the non-self-adjoint version of this. So you just have a rectangular matrix where all entries are independent and have the Gaussian distribution. Okay, and if you take X, such a Ginepro guy, and you look on all its star moments, which means any possible traces of products of X and X star in any order, then you get a limiting distribution. And this limiting object we call a circular object. I mean, on first order level, that's a circular operator of Voiculescu, but this is also in higher order. We define this operator C as a limit of X, X and star, where this here is a Ginepro matrix. In particular, I mean, if you multiply X with X star, then you get a Wishart matrix. So this is what we call a circular operator or element. I mean, usually you do this on the first order level, but now we do it on all levels. So we say a circular element is defined by this, and actually we can describe this very nicely. And it's usually as with many descriptions in terms of cumulants are much better. So if you have a Gaussian variable in a classical context, of course you can write down the moments, but the cumulants, it's much easier because you say it's only the second order cumulant, which is different from zero, and all the other ones are zero. That's the sense of Wick formula. And here actually the circular element, you can also describe very easily in terms of cumulants. Namely, it says that only second order in first order, you only have the cumulants where you connect C with C star. It's an analog of the classical complex Gaussian variable. So this means I only have kappa two of C C star, and this is the same as kappa two of C star C. This is equal to one, and all other cumulants are zero. Also the higher order ones, all higher order ones are zero. So all other cumulants are zero. So there's a very easy description. And of course with this, you have also ways of describing all the moments. Okay, and now we have this theorem that conjugation by the CC star actually changes moments into cumulants. So this is really, a concrete realization of going over from moments to cumulants. So this is a theorem. So this is, together with Octavio Arismendi and my PhD student Felix Light and myself, which we are just doing recently. And the first order version of this is well known. The second order version of this was done in a recent, or in this preprint, which you had at the beginning of Jamie and Octavio, but we can also do it in higher orders. So this tells us that if I have, let's say, A and C, let them be free, but free of all orders now. I consider now, and C is the circular element. So C is circular, but A is arbitrary. So I assume I have this A, and now I go over from A to a conjugated version of this, which I call B. So B is C, A, C star. Then of course I'm changing the distribution. B has not the same distribution of A. If I'm conjugating with a high unitary, of course, I'm not changing the distribution. But here, of course, I'm changing it. And The point is, I'm changing it so that the cumulants of B are given by the moments of A. So this is exactly, of course, relates to this question. So then we have that the moments, I mean, in any order, L1 up to Ln, let's say, of B is given by the corresponding moment of A. So for L1 up to Ln. This is true for all n and all choices of L. Okay, and maybe as a final remark, I mean, this allows us, for example, in particular, to look, I mean, in this context, of course, the question would be, if A satisfies topological recursion, then does B satisfy topological recursion? Okay, at least we cannot do this in this generality at the moment, but we can at least look on specific situations like this, namely if I start with a C and then I do this conjugation several times, it just means I'm multiplying independent C's or free C's on the level of random matrices. This means I'm taking products of independent Ginipre matrices. And for this, then actually, I mean, putting everything together, what we know from our work and work of other people, we know that they satisfy topological recursion. So we also have this theorem by Octavio, Felix, and myself. Let's choose for the A also another free version of the C and then maybe repeat this. So actually I consider different CIs which are free and each of them is circular. And then I take the product of them for a fixed number of factors. Huh? So let me call this HK. This is C1, C2 up to CK. But now let me really go over to a self-adjoint variable. So let's take the Wishart version of this. So multiply this with its adjoint, because that's also what I'm doing there with the conjugation. So I take CK star, C2 star, C1 star. So this HK is really a self-adjoint guy. And then the question is, the moments of this guy, do they satisfy topological recursion? And actually, I mean, because we have this description of our functions, we actually know what the moments are, namely those are the numbers which are appearing in paper of Busquet, Melou, and Scheffer. So I mean, they are also called Busquet, Melou, Scheffer numbers. And of course, in our case, I mean, you have those numbers of all genus. In our case, it's just the genus zero case of this. So then we know that the collection of the moments of this HK, which actually are then, of course, the cumulants of the HK plus one or HK minus one, because I mean, if you go one step further, you just change moments to cumulants. So those are numbers for which you have precise explicit combinatorial formulas, but of course they are not usually very helpful, but you have quite a couple of descriptions for them. Those numbers for G equal to zero. And I mean, in a recent paper of Vichko, Dun, Barkowski, and Chadrin, I mean, it is shown that we have topological recursion for them. This means that, for those guys here, so that actually for the product of independent Ginipre matrices, that they satisfy a topological recursion. And actually this was something which was considered by Forrester for the product of two. And I mean, he has some results in this direction and he's, I think, conjecturing topological recursion, but he could not prove it. And I mean, I think this, taking all those things together, proves this not just for the product of two, but for any product. So those are those BMS numbers, and thus they satisfy topological recursion by this work of Chico, Dun, and Chatrin. Okay, and of course, I think, I mean, they show that they satisfy topological recursion involving all genera, but anyhow. Okay, so maybe that, I hope this shows that there is some relation between free probability theory. I mean, we are not directly asking the same question as in topological recursion. Maybe we're asking a direct question which goes in a little bit different direction, but of course, there is a big combination that one can combine those questions. So, I mean, topological recursion, I think, is about universal relation, which you can find, let's say, in a sequence of moments. So you have in many situations, you have universal relations. So what we do in free probability is more universal constructions. So if you have sequences of moments, you want to construct new ones out of them in a universal way. So freeness is this universal way. Yeah, but then of course, you can combine this and ask essentially questions. If you have topological recursions for some sequences of numbers, and then you construct in this universal way given by free probability new sequences of numbers out of them, do they also satisfy topological recursion? Or maybe more generally, you could ask what type of relation is preserved by doing those type of constructions. And I mean, there are several versions of topological recursion, so one could also, I mean, ask all those questions. For this, yeah, okay. So I think this hopefully, yeah, gives you an idea what the relation between those things are. And in particular, of course, as I always told you, I'm only looking on the planar sector G equal to zero, and I'm not so sure how rigid the structure is for subleading orders. But of course, topological recursion suggests that there still should be something. And when I showed you the relation between the cumulants of traces and the cumulants of the entries of the matrix, in these formulas, you also have suborder terms, which I ignored. Okay, and I mean, Elba and Guettant, I mean, they showed that for the maps, you have the same relation between that, at least for G equal to zero. I'm not sure whether the relation which they have between their maps is the same relation that we have between the traces and the cumulants. So maybe it's the same, which of course would suggest that, okay, this is also something interesting one should try to understand it. Maybe in particular to understand whether there is a notion of freeness which goes for general G, which probably means that one should look on cumulants for general G and then try to understand the vanishing of mixed cumulants, what one can say about this. Of course, you can define it, but it should have some more structure. And I'm not sure. I mean, the crucial thing for me is that if you have two things which are free, functions of them should also be free. And I'm not so sure whether this this would be preserved for higher genus. Okay. I mean, even without this, it might be an interesting structure. But this would be one of the first questions, I think, which one should address. Good. Okay. So I think that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
So thank you, Roland, for this very nice and stimulating lecture. We'll first take questions. There are questions.
I try to come back to your last question. So you said first, maybe a comment on what you just said. When you go to higher genus, if you just take two random matrices unitary invariant, to simplify, let's say each of them is with a measure which is just trace of V of M. Then the type of notion we have, I mean, some of these free at higher genus or this fully simple map do have this property that you don't mix. When you look to the mixed moments, but fully simple boundary condition, there's no possible interaction between the two. And that's true to any genus. So I think that does a linearization that you want, but in this very particular setting. Mm-hmm. But my question was, so you mentioned there's a relation between moments and cumulants, and you wonder if it's the same as between the maps. But yeah, you were talking about something different than maps and fully simple maps, or?
No, I mean, I showed you, I mean, the relation between moments and cumulants, I derived it from looking what is the relation between classical cumulants of traces and classical cumulants of entries of the matrices. I derived the formula, but then I only kept the leading order, the G equal to the geodesic part of this formula. But of course, this formula has subleading terms, which I have never looked at. And I mean, your relation between ordinary maps and fully simple maps, of course, has formulas relations on all levels, and I wonder whether this is the same as for...
Yes, the generating series of ordinary maps is the expectation value of traces of powers, so normal moments.
Okay.
If you do connected, it's cumulants. And if you want the fully simple map, and this is true to all genus, if you want the fully simple maps, you do exactly the observable for which you take the leading order. So it's kind of a cycle, but fixing indices and disjoint cycles.
Okay, so it's clear that it, that
this isn't
it's
our the same
and because, okay, because you have topological recursion for this. I mean, this yes. also gives okay support that it would be interesting to look on those things from the free probability point of view. Yeah.
Yes. Are there other questions in the room or in the also in for people who are on internet, if they want to ask questions, they can just ask questions directly by the microphone.
Hi. So my question is, can we forget about the definition of second order freeness, then take the second order, free cumulants for second order, and then we take the functional relation? Does that imply the definition?
I mean, for freeness, you have to look on several matrices. I mean, those functional relations are just between moments of one. You're only looking on one matrix. Those guys don't really, you don't see the freeness there. This is just about how you go from moments to cumulants. I mean, moments and cumulants we have in a multivariate case. And there we only have the combinatorial formulas. But if you specify it to the one, to one variable, then you can rewrite those combinatorial formulas into this formal power series. But of course, on this level, you don't see the full structure of freeness. Huh?
You don't see the freeness, but you see the you can see the relation between moments and the free cumulants through these partition permutations.
Yeah. I mean, this formula is equivalent to, right? To the combinatorial okay. description.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Maybe I have a last question. If you start from monotone or Boolean independence, can you do something similar? Or?
Yeah, no, I don't know, because I mean I told you that I get the inspiration from random matrix models, and I think for monotone and Boolean we don't have so clear random matrix models.
Because it could be that Boolean could be related to some form of very simple form of topological recursion in some way.
Maybe, but
because that's simple.
Okay, I don't know. I mean, you would need the higher orders. Huh? Just being on a base level is not. It's really about going to all orders.
So I suggest we thank again very much Roland for his series of lectures.